Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Gary Olson, and I have the pleasure to serve as president of Daemen College. I want to welcome you to our campus and thank you for attending our fourth Distinguished Leaders Lecture. Now, we're privileged and honored to have speaking at Daemen today one of the most distinguished members of the Foreign Service of India and one of India's most important representatives to the United States, Ambassador D.M. Mulay. Ambassador, it's a special day for us at Daemen to have you here as part of our Distinguished Leaders Lectures. Also, we're honored to have with us, to formally introduce the ambassador, my friend and colleague, Dr. Satish Tripathi, president of the State University of New York at Buffalo. But before I turn to Dr. Tripathi to introduce the speaker, I'd like to give some recognition to some of our important guests who are in attendance. In attendance is one of the state's most distinguished members of the State Assembly and a true friend of Daemen College, Assemblyman Roger Scheminger. Robin, would you rise and be recognized?
I'm standing now.
There you go. We're delighted to have with us two distinguished members of Daemen College's Board of Trustees. They can rise too, I hope. Ms. Caroline Burke and Ms. Audrey Bunis. Please rise and be recognized. Next, I want to single out another very special person at Daemen College, Mr. Bob Beiswanger. Bob is our Vice President for Business Affairs and was retiring on August 1st. Remarkable career, 31 years. I'd like also to recognize two other vital members of our leadership team, Dr. Greg Nayer, our Vice President for Student Affairs. Greg. And I wanted to recognize our outgoing Chair of Senate, Michelle Flint, but she's not here right now. So, but we can clap for her in her absence. And finally, I'm pleased to welcome the most important guest today, Dr. Lynn Worsham, a distinguished scholar, my wife, and my best advisor. So. Now, someone who is not with us today is our esteemed friend and Congressman Brian Higgins, who worked with Ambassador's Buffalo-based friend, a distinguished physician, Dr. Kulant Bangu, to help bring the ambassador here. And in fact, while we're at it, let's recognize Dr. Bangu. Would you stand and be recognized? Now, let me briefly say a few words about the lecture series. The intent of this series is to bring to campus political leaders, government officials, and members of the judiciary from both political parties and from all parts of the political spectrum. Congressman Higgins has been our lecturer here, as has Eric Cantor, the majority leader of the House of Representatives, and Congressman Woman Debbie Wasserman Schultz was also here. Distinguished lecturers share their respective and often very different views on issues of importance of our day. And this exposure to national, and now with us today, international leaders is good for our students, good for our faculty and staff, and good for the community we serve. Clearly, this series demonstrates that Daemen College is kind of a big tent under which leaders can share their diverse views in a nonpartisan forum and have their views respected with both interest and respect. Now it is my distinct honor to introduce one of the state's most respected and distinguished university presidents and professors, at that matter. Dr. Satish Tripathi is an outstanding educator, scholar, and leader of the state's flagship public university. We're fortunate to have him today to introduce our speaker, Dr. Satish Tripathi.
Thank you, President Olson. Thank you for this honor for me to be here to introduce our speaker. Before I introduce our speaker, I want to say a few words, actually, and it's really important for me to sort of think about it. And when Dr. Olson called me to say that he wanted me to introduce, I started thinking about you. I'm from India. I grew up in India, and actually I read Ambassador Mulay's bio, and it reminded me of me growing up in India as well. He's from a very small village, and I come from similar background, except for two different regions, actually. He can speak my language. I can't speak his, actually. That's the. But the topic that the Ambassador Mulay is addressing today, emerging India and Indo-American relations, is a subject of great interest and significance, particularly to our higher education community. The two of the world's largest higher education systems, India and US, have much to learn from each other and many shared interests and concerns in common. The higher education concerns are really the same at both places: the cost of education, MOOCs, and access to education. These are really the real issues in both countries. In the global world of 21st century, educational exchange and academic partnership are among the most important of these shared priorities. India is a model for the US in terms of cross-cultural exchange. The movement of students between two countries continue to be more or less a one-way street, with US benefiting greatly from the academic talent in India. Far larger number of Indian students undertake study abroad and learn foreign languages than US students do. India has for several years been one of the leading countries of the origin among international students coming to US. It's actually number two now. It used to be number one at one point, and it fluctuates between one and two. At any given time, actually, there are about 100,000, take or add a few more, Indian students studying in US, and actually that number is increasing the last few years as more and more undergraduate students are now coming to US to study. I believe strongly that the US needs to balance the mobility equation by continuing to send more US students and faculty abroad. We at UB are trying that as well. Our goal is to have, right now we send about 14% of our students for study abroad. Our goal is to 20% and go beyond that as well. India provides a very worthy example in this regard. In our 21st century knowledge economy, scholarly collaboration, innovation, and educational exchange across international borders have never been more important. Technological development and a rapidly evolving global economy are making our world increasingly interconnected. By and large, national companies today, I'm not talking about international, national companies today are all global enterprises, as are higher education institutions. As these geographic boundaries become increasingly blurred, partnership across international borders is essential. And higher education institutions play a leadership role in facilitating international collaboration by virtue of what we do through cultivating understanding, broadening perspectives, and fostering cross-cultural dialogue. The India-US relationship is an especially important one in this respect. In fact, President Obama and former Indian Prime Minister Dr. Manmohan Singh have described the relationship between India and United States as the defining partnership of 21st century, with education and knowledge as key pillars of the India-US strategic relationship. This is and must be a bi-directional partnership, offering the opportunity to learn from one another's examples in the realms of higher learning and research, while building the capacity of global skill sets to our mutual advantage. Today, our regional community has the opportunity to hear about some critical issues from the perspective of a very important figure in the area of international relations. Ambassador Dnyaneshwar Mulay took office as Consul General of India in New York in 2013. He is internationally distinguished for his contributions in the field of diplomatic relations and global affairs, and has served in numerous important posts, including those of High Commissioner of India, Mulay and Maldives, Foreign Service Advisor to the Cabinet Secretariat in the Government of India, Minister of Economic and Political Affairs in the Embassy of India in Damascus, and key diplomatic post in Mauritius, New Delhi, Tokyo, and Moscow. Something that is not in his bio, in the official bio, but if you search a little more, you'll find that he's also a prolific writer. He has written 15 books, and the books have been translated in multiple languages. His book on Russia is kind of a book that's required reading for people interested in Russian relations. So really, you know, I don't know where he gets the time as a diplomatic ambassador and as the head of the mission in New York, but he continues to be a prolific writer. And today he will be bringing this comprehensive global perspective and his own perspective as a writer and author to bear on this topic of emerging India and Indo-American relations. And now it is my pleasure to introduce the Consul General of India in New York, Ambassador Dnyaneshwar Mulay.
Well, in India, we start with Namaste. Namaste is as old as the civilization of India, maybe 4,000 years old, 5,000 years old. And it, what does it mean? It means that that which lies within me, the divine, bows in front of you to that which lies within you. That's the depth of India. Ladies and gentlemen, President, Madam Olson, I met both of them yesterday and I've been enjoying the hospitality of Buffalo. Dr. Bangu, who has been instrumental in sort of encouraging me to come here. In my first visit, in his first visit to New York to meet me, he asked me, have you been to Buffalo? I said, no, but I'd like to go as early as possible. And within no time, he organized this visit. I'm very grateful to you. Congressman, Assemblyman, maybe very soon. Ladies and gentlemen, what a great pleasure and privilege it's for me. I'm not going to bore you at all with very heavy dose of diplomatic language, partly because I don't know much about that. And as Dr. Tripathi very gently raised this question as to where do I get time to write, question is, where do I get time to speak to people? Wherever I get time to speak to people, that's my way of learning. That's my source of learning. And this, whatever interaction I have with the people, wherever I'm posted, I take it back home. And whenever I get time, I jot it down. And that's how my books are created. It's an interesting topic. Now, emerging India. Now, do we suggest that India is emerging, or do we suggest that we have been there for 5,000 years, so we have been continuously emerging and evolving? Or is it the relationship that is evolving or emerging? Doesn't matter, I think. Every place is emerging. But just to, you know, this is a fascinating thought that the gentleman who wanted to discover India for a very simple reason, that he was not getting his spices. Or the Europe was not getting its spices. So people decided that they must find a sea route. So the gentleman who left the shores of Europe to discover India, he ultimately landed to a place which he didn't know about, and he started calling it India. That's how you have so many Indians, much before Indians started coming here. I think it's a strange coincidence, but it also symbolizes one thing, that India has been a land of aspiration. There is something of an Indian dream, just as there is something as an American dream. Our Prime Minister, who just elected 2 months back, he was a chaiwala. Chai means tea in Indian languages. And chaiwala means one who served tea at the railway platforms. Our Prime Minister, the current Prime Minister, who was chosen by 565 voters, out of 850 registered voters, was in his younger days selling tea. I say that, you know, the dream that perhaps Columbus saw in terms of wanting to find a route to the spices in India, is still alive. It's still alive in so many ways. And the place where he ultimately landed, and which became kind of a new dream world for many people, the place of Big Apple, the ultimate dream, democracy really settled down here well, prospered, thrived. What about India? I always feel that India is a country where maybe we have not used the word democracy, because English language came to us much later than several other languages were spoken in India. Somebody asked me yesterday, in fact, dinner, how many languages do you have? So one of the Indians present there said 35 languages and 350 dialects. But I think that's perhaps not a correct figure. We might have more than 2,000 dialects. And we have several languages, certainly, you know, more than 20, 30, which are spoken by a large number of people. And I also showed a currency note, Indian currency note, which has inscriptions in 17 languages. If you have any doubt about that, after this meeting, I'm ready to show. I always carry a 10 rupee note with me. What does it indicate? It indicates a very basic thing, that just as you say here that e pluribus unum, right? While many, you are one. We are a little exactly the same, but we express it differently. We say ekoham bahusyam, means while one, I am many. It's a fascinating difference. A distinction, because you are aware right now of the various streams that have made this country so rich. In our case, we're not even aware. So we think that we are one, and from this oneness derive many names. There are any number of ancient Sanskrit mantras or shlokas, couplets of poetry, which indicate the diversity of India, giving the names of rivers, giving the names of languages. So it's really fascinating. When did Judaism go to India? Judaism arrived in India in 562 BC. India is perhaps, not perhaps, India is the only country where Jews were never persecuted. And they lived for several centuries without having to change their religion, without having to change their names, without having to change their rituals, without having to change their prayers, without having to change their temples and books. It's amazing. And that, I think, really think is the strength of India. Christianity came to India much before it came to Europe. It came immediately, somewhere around 30 AD and 50 AD. I exactly don't remember the date. St. Thomas was the first person to come to India. Have you heard a name of a religion called Parsi? Yes. People from the Iranian Persian area who were persecuted, they left, came to India, settled down, lived there happily ever after. Many of them are even now prominent Indian businessmen. If you've heard the names of Tatas, Godrej, these are some of the leading companies in India right now. They have been able to maintain everything that they brought from Persia in those centuries. Then we also had, you know, Hinduism is a very, very weird and unique religion. You can be an agnostic and be an Indian, be a Hindu. You can be an atheist and be a Hindu. Actually, as a Hindu, you can go to a church, mosque, because you have this basic feeling that God is everywhere. So, ekoham vipra bahuda vadanti. While I am one, the wise people call me by various names. That's one of our ancient adage. It says that, you know, basically, whichever God you want to salute, bow to, you know, pay your respects, obeisance, or prayers, it will reach to that one ultimate entity. That's the underlying philosophy and thought in the Hindu religion. That's why, strangely, there is no concept of conversion in Hinduism. Everybody has to be born in, you know, in all other religions, some point of time you have to be baptized. Some point of time you need to be initiated. While in Hinduism, you are just born there. So it's very interesting concept that there is no, and the reason perhaps is because there was never, because it emerged in a civilizational flow, there isn't one way of following Hinduism. And this has enormously affected the thinking of anybody who comes into the stream called India. It has to be like that. If you see the Indian Islam, it's a very, very gentle form of Islam, by and large. Every religion has a fringe which might be moving towards fundamentalism. But if you see, by and large, you have not heard too much about terrorism of Islamic fundamentalists in India. We have, most of it is imported from elsewhere. At the time of independence of India, 1947, we had the choice, perhaps, the then leaders would have had the choice of perhaps making India a Hindu state, Hindu nation. It wasn't made. The reason, again, is this philosophical depth that all of us are one. We should not really be, just because we are a majority, we should not really call ourselves by Hindu nation. We are, so India is a secular country. And it gives same rights to everybody. I think I strongly recommend those of you who have not seen the Constitution of India, it's available now thanks to the internet. Go through it when you have time. It's really one of the superb documents of how a state should conduct itself. And of course, we have learned a lot from the United States America, which to me looks very much like India. It's a modern-day India. And we are an ancient American civilization in a very interesting way. It's sort of maybe a mission of India is being carried by the United States of America. It's just similar. You have enshrined what you call pursuit of life, liberty, and happiness. We have similar principles. There are fundamental rights. There's a provision for justice, social, economic, political. Affirmative action, you know, is a catchword in the U.S. The Long March took place in 1962, if I'm not mistaken. Civil Rights Act came much later. But in 1948, the Indian makers of the Indian Constitution had the vision of enshrining the rights of women to vote, rights of every person to vote, rich, poor. Prior to 1947, there were voting rights in India under the British rule, but not everybody could vote. So, but the first opportunity, the Constitution was made, and everybody was given right to vote, everybody who is above 21. And from the day one, in India, every citizen, that is January 26, 1950, we adopted our Constitution. Everybody who is in that country, who is born in that country, who is a citizen of country, has the same rights and obligations. So in so many ways, today this friendship, we have this 68th year of our independence. We are not United States, and yet our destinies have brought us together, particularly in the post-Cold War era. We have come much closer strategically, philosophically, and theoretically, and in terms of values, I think we have won. But now, the history and the course of history has brought us together. The challenges that are there today, whether it is extremism, whether it is facing the challenge of climate change, whether it is addressing basic issues like food security, whether it is more strategic issues like how to manage nuclear arsenal, how to see our future in the space. I think there is a lot that is going on together between India and USA. But prior to that also, there's certain interesting episodes of cooperation and taking inspiration from each other. The gentleman who was responsible to make our constitution, one Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, himself, what you call quote-unquote untouchable by birth, he was, again, the beauty of the working together of our so-called independence movement that was led by Mahatma Gandhi was such that he brought the entire nation together. And this gentleman, Dr. Ambedkar, was in those days perhaps one of the most highly educated persons in the world. He had a degree from Columbia. He had a degree from London School of Economics. And he had studied law here. There's a statue of Dr. Ambedkar in Columbia University. 1913, he came here and he got his inspiration. He saw this society and how it has enshrined the principles of equality. And he went back and he is the architect of Indian affirmative action. And, as somebody who has worked in the government, I have had the opportunity of seeing how the affirmative action has actually changed the fate of a large number of Indian people and brought them directly into the mainstream. They are in the educational institutions, certainly. They are in the government jobs, no doubt. They're also at any given point of time, at least 33% of our representatives in the parliament belong to the less privileged class. That is a very strong voice at the national level and in legislative affairs. So Ambedkar himself was greatly inspired by the United States. Coming to Martin Luther King Jr., he was greatly inspired by Gandhi. And he did visit India, and he did visit all the places which were inhabited by Gandhiji. And Gandhiji himself was inspired by his stay in South Africa, where he actually experimented. And in turn, Nelson Mandela was greatly inspired by Gandhiji. So these are very interesting streams of influencing each other, give and take. There was a small team of young Indian students in the Bay Area in the early last century, and they formed a small party called Gadar Party. It was an organization of rebels based in Bay Area who fought or who created support for the Indian independence movement while being in the United States, the Indian students here. Well, Boston Tea Party, you all remember Boston Tea Party, but you don't know where did the tea come from. This tea came from the plantations that were grown by the Britishers in India. And the one particular tea box that has been preserved in Boston, and I went and saw it, it does have a mark to indicate that it has come from India. So these are very, very interesting connections. We have been inspiring each other in very, very positive ways. And now, actually, it's a very, very strong relationship as of today, very strong relationship. Dr. Bangu is a physician who is based here, very successful. But I think he's just one example of those 15% of the total physicians of the United States of America who come from India. So that 15% of all physicians in the United States of America come from India. And it's a very remarkable thing. And of course, what it really means is it also highlights that the Indian education is good. Earlier in the 80s and 70s, people generally had a very, very, a negative image of India. People thought that India really was about slums. India was really about stark poverty. India was about elephants and tigers and lions all on the, sitting on the street, or maybe cows on the street. Now, the Indian education has played a very, very major role in changing the image of India. A few years back when our Prime Minister, then Prime Minister Manmohan Singh came to the United States of America, one cartoon showed him and President Obama walking together after the press conference, and President Obama patting the back of Prime Minister Manmohan Singh and telling him that, oh, our White House computers are not working. Why don't you do something about them? There's a new image that, you know, everybody in India has some kind of an IT, has to be an IT expert. That new image has now, you know, taken over the old image of poverty, deprivation, slums. So just as this image is not true entirely, and you know, just as this old image of stark poverty was also not entirely true, because India has been, has been a country of huge paradoxes, huge contradictions, and a huge socio-economic inequality as a product of history. So considering that, I think we seem to be moving in the right direction as a country which has been largest democracy since 1950s, because prior to that we took 2.5 years approximately to create our constitution. It's never veered away from the democratic path. Nobody ever asks the question now, except for some skeptics in Europe and United States of America, what's going to happen to democracy in India. Nobody now really worries about whether there will be elections in India. Elections have been held. They've been held regularly, and they'll continue to be held regularly. People have simply made elections as a habit. And after every 5 years, whether it is a village level, whether it is a municipality or the city, whether it is state, or whether it is center, elections have to be held. And for such a large country, such a diverse country, which has almost every religion of the world, almost every ethnicity, people and the topography is very diverse, there's never been a doubt whether the elections will be held. And, you know, just as the last elections were particularly, I would say, phenomenal. As I mentioned, you had 850 million registered voters, but we also had 565 million people who actually voted. What it means is, looking at New York's mayoral election recently, where I'm told about 28% people voted, the 65% people nationally voting is something of a record. It's also phenomenal in the sense the way it is conducted. Indian elections are 100% electronically operated. We employed about 1.4 million electronic voting machines. What it really means is there is no paper to be used anymore. You have the names of the candidates, and you have their symbols. You whatever you want to choose, you you know, press that button and it gets registered. And there's never a mistake, because now it's everything is electronically counted. So 1.4 million of these electronic machines and 900,000 booths all over the country. Wherever there is even one person living, he has to be provided with an election booth for voting within 2 kilometers of his residence. As a result, the officers set out sometimes on boats, sometimes on elephants, sometimes even on donkey, you know, or mules back, and sometimes wherever nothing can go, they put the voting machines on their back, walk for several kilometers, and go to the place, sometimes in a very mountainous terrain, to establish the election booth. But it is ensured that nobody suffers, you know, from a lack of, except that I can't vote. I'm so far away. And even if the election ballot paper does come to me, but my vote, generally by the time it goes, all the election results are out. So it's a phenomenally well-conducted and impartial elections where nobody doubts, there is no dispute about the outcome of the election. I sometimes find in the United States, the elections are very, very, from our point of view, very, very funny. And we don't understand how suddenly somebody concedes or somebody, you know, claims victory. We say the number should say it all. But I'm told here the system really works very, very differently, even though, you know, it's at one level, it's very streamlined. So compared to that, this, you know, such a huge operation of election, really what it shows is democracy in India is going to be, you know, a very, very stronger. And I always feel when I think about Indo-US relations, we are 1.2 billion and United States is 300 million. That makes it 1.5 billion. If this 1.5 billion population really decides to work on a common agenda, we can really play a great role in shaping the destiny of our planet. That's really my vision. And that therefore, it's very important that there is, number one, understanding of this partnership, and number two, then there is, you know, effort to strengthen it as much as possible from both the sides. So as I was referring, the current relationship is very fascinating. Our trade is in the tune of about $100 billion. It's not very small, but it's not very big either. My hunch is we're not touched even the tip of the iceberg in terms of economic relations. There are investments from the United States into India, and United States is one of the largest investors. But for the last 5 years, it's India who is investing more in the United States than United States investing in India. Our image issue, if you ask any Indian, which is the most favorite country of yours, it's likely that most Indians would point out to the United States of America. United States is an aspirational destination for many Indians, including younger Indians. But more than that, I think what they like about United States is basically its opportunities to grow, the environment of creativity and environment of innovative encouragement. That's what really, and that's what the students are coming to this country in such big numbers. Talking of students, I tried to make a rough calculation. 100,000 students spending about $30,000 a year in this country, that alone works out to be about $3 billion is what the Indian students or Indian maybe parents are spending in this country. It's a very interesting relationship. About 90% of this country's gems and jewelry and diamonds and precious stone business now is in the hands of Indians. It's a little known factor, but that's true. Indians are also very active as taxi drivers. One third of New York's taxi drivers are from South Asia, and most of them are Indians. Engineers, IT people are, India has emerged as United States, perhaps the biggest outsourcing partner. And that relationship is thriving and growing. Many companies, including IBM, have more employees in India than even in the United States. So this partnership is really multidimensional, growing. On the educational front, Dr. Satish Tripathi is a good example. But not only in the Buffalo University, but universities like Harvard, universities like Princeton, and universities all over this country, Indians are occupying important posts in major universities. They are working in the areas of research and development big time. Many Indians, after coming to the United States and staying here for a long period, have also earned Nobel Prize. Hargobind Khurana is just one example of this kind. But people who are not perhaps got their Nobel, but also have done equivalent good work, like Bose of the Bose sound system. He came from India. So there is a huge partnership that's going on at multiple levels. At government-to-government level, I would say the relationship is excellent. But what is also important is people-to-people level relationship is very, very getting very, very strong. We have about 4.5 million people in this country right now of Indian origin. They're not necessarily American citizens, but most of them are. Many of them are aspiring. But certainly they are contributing to this country. The profile of Indians in this country is again amazing, because most of them, they are well-placed. Most of them are contributing to the income tax. And recently I asked a well-placed Indian in the Wall Street to give me a rough calculation of figures of what contribution Indians in this country are making to the exchequer of this country. And he gave me a ballpoint figure of $100 billion. I thought it was a very, very fascinating figure. My own estimates did not allow me to go beyond $10 billion. I thought 10 billion, I was becoming very, very ambitious. But he told me that considering their net worth, considering their contribution, considering their place, 100 billion is a reasonable amount that Indians would be paying to the income tax, IRS, or whatever department in taxation to this country. I thought that was an enormous contribution. We also tried last 1 year to find out how many employees are being employed by Indians in this country, Indian entrepreneurs, Indian hotel owners, Indian business owners, and a rough figure of 1 million plus has emerged when you take the entire a spectrum of Indian employment in this country. So what I'm trying to point out at is really this is a remarkable relationship. I also ask people whether they have any difficulty in sort of mixing in this country, mixing with the people here. Do they suffer any discrimination? And most of them absolutely without hesitation say that there is absolutely no discrimination. Not only that, they are respected, and they're able to easily assimilate in this country. So that I thought partly it might be due to the English language, but I think it's partly because the culture that we bring, by nature, Indians are not if you have to define nations between aggressive nations and peaceful nations, aggressive people and peaceful people, I would define India to be a peaceful nation and of peaceful people. Because in 5,000 years of history, Rarely will you find any examples that Indians have gone out in full force and, you know, tried to conquer other territories or countries. And that is again because the religious values that we have nurtured, or the spiritual values that we have nurtured, doesn't really allow us to grab anything from anybody. And I think that really, as a value, is very, very important. And, you know, in coexistence has been the mantra for India for several centuries, and that is how it will continue. At educational level, it's growing, but health sector, as I mentioned about, but not only the physicians, there's a huge exchange between the pharmaceutical health industry here and pharmaceutical health industry in India. Large number of American pharmaceutical companies have their production facilities in India, and they've been working there for several years very successfully. High-tech, defense, nuclear, space, all these areas, India and US are working very, very closely. Just to give you two examples, India is the largest importer of US defense products, and one that pays for its imports. You know, it's everything. And now we have recently sort of liberalized our defense sector, and where foreign investment in defense is allowed, so more investments are likely, foreign direct investment in India from the United States in the defense sector. India and US hold the largest number of military exercises, joint military exercises, than any other country, both bilaterally as well as, you know, with other countries. So I'm just saying, because India is a faraway country, I think often most people do not know much about India. They know a little bit through their Indian friends. But if you ask them in a little bit in detail, they aren't really aware. So this is, again, a very, very strong partnership. At government to government level, we have more than 30 joint working groups that are working together. And I think that we were waiting for the new government to be in place. Now the new government is not only in place, we will be having very soon the visit of our Prime Minister, who will be spending about 3 days in New York and 1 day in D.C. I think that smile is very much warranted. Yes, it shows the emphasis, importance, as well as the strength of this relationship. You know, he is the new Prime Minister and the earlier Prime Ministers. If there is one difference, is that the new Prime Minister is an economic Prime Minister. He has come, he's got elected, he's come to power on the basis of his economic agenda. He has campaigned in favor of growth, economic development, and employment generation. He was a chief minister, equivalent to somewhat like governor here, of a state called Gujarat. And there, he successfully showed that the growth rate of his state was successively higher than most other Indian states. He also laid great emphasis, and recently he said that it's not temples, but toilets that should be built in India. For somebody who has often been, you know, accused as a Hindu nationalist, this is a huge thing to say in India. So it also makes very clear that, you know, he is going to embark on economic cooperation. And in my view, when he is here in the United States in September, the economic agenda is what will really constitute a major part of his job. It's true. Dr. Satish has rightly pointed out that Obama, President Obama, has said and announced that this is the defining partnership between India and of the 21st century. But how will it happen? It'll happen only when everybody realizes the worth of this relationship. There is more understanding of it, and people actively explore the opportunities that exist. I would say huge opportunities exist in India. So minimum that we could do is encourage our American friends to go to India. In my consulate, I issue about 100,000 visas for India every year. This is the largest visa issued by any consulate, any Indian consulate, anywhere in the world. But my ambition is not to issue 100,000, but I would like to issue 1 million visas. So, but you all need to go to India and explore India. Only when you go, there will be partnerships. You will be able to understand how India, it is important. Seeing is believing. So I promise you visas without any delays. And if the President Daemen College or President University of Buffalo or the Assemblyman, if they recommend, I'll give you a 10-year multiple entry visa to India without any problem. In consulate, I'm very proud of the fact that in consulate we have initiated a number of new experimental things. We have established a film and literature club. We also have our own distinguished lecture series, and maybe we took inspiration from you, where every month we get a prominent Indian or American to come to the consulate and speak on an important issue. Next month we have going to have one of our Grand Prix winners in tennis, Leander Pace, and he will be speaking on sports and India-US relations. So I'm trying to sort of, give as much push as possible to this very, very interesting and fascinating relationship. We also started, for your information, in the consulate, a concept of one and a half hour tour of the consulate. Particularly, this is aimed at students and children. So anybody who wants to see what is the Indian consulate, what goes on inside, how the business is conducted, how visa is printed, how passport is made. You know, we take on a small tour, show the Gandhiji statue and explain about the man and his mission. We tell him about the President of India, Prime Minister of India. Then they are led to the Consul General's room, which is mine. And we have a question answer session and a photo session. We also tell them about the history of our building, which was a prime property belonging to the Astor family. And currently I occupy the same bedroom as of Lady Astor. So it's a fascinating, so we're trying to do as many things as possible. We're also trying to focus, start a new series called India State by State. Not step by step, but state by state. To introduce our states, we have 29 states and 7 union territories. But most of you won't be knowing. You know perhaps Mumbai, you know perhaps Delhi, and some of you might be knowing Bangalore, which is popular here as compared to many other cities. But beyond that, there is a beautiful India. There is an India of lions and tigers, not in the zoos or in the cages, but out there in the open. There is an India of elephants. There is an India of rhinos. There is India of snow and Himalayan peaks. There's India of beautiful beaches like Goa. There's India of temples and churches. Again, Goa and south of India, but all over India you'll see. So, India is full of colors and moods and full of... Somebody asked me the other day, what is that one thing you would like to say about India? I said, India is about 1.2 billion stories. I think that's a never-ending saga. And I'm glad that our two countries are now, have met together and, are walking hand in hand. We will be very happy at the consulate and at the embassy to, help you out in whatever manner you want to promote this partnership, because I believe that it'll really succeed and it'll really pick up and it'll go to the next level only when people on both sides put their full force behind this relationship. I wonder whether I have touched all the aspects. But on the economic side, India has grown in the last 2 decades at the rate of about 6 to 7%. And it's with the new elections in place and a very, very dynamic prime minister who is focusing on the economic aspect. We have just had a very, very interesting budget, national budget presented. And it shows the direction in which the new budget is going. But I'm not going to go into those details. I'd like to just quote our Prime Minister when he accepted his leadership role in the Parliament. He said of his party, political party, he said a very interesting thing. He said that when a glass is half full, some people say that the glass is half full, while some people say the glass is half empty. This is what the Prime Minister says. And then he says, I belong to the third category. I think that the glass is half full with water and half full with air. Unquote. What I learned from this particular message of Prime Minister is, you must learn to see meaning where none is visible to the naked eyes. Thank you so much.
Very inspiring. And I heard the ambassador say that your year of independence was 1947, and that's also the year that Daemen College was born. So we were both born together. Hopefully we'll have many ties in the future. I know we're supposed to end about right now, but let's try to get just a few questions in. Bobby Mills here has the microphone. So if you raise your hand, we'll begin over here with Brian Rusk. Or whoever you, whoever.
We'll start with the gentleman,
closest.
And then we'll
okay.
go.
Ambassador Mulay, my name is Srihari. I'm originally from Bangalore, India. I lived here in Buffalo for the last 35 years. I'm a professor at UB. I found your talk very inspiring. It was beyond my expectation of what a consul general from New York might have to say. But thank you for a very nice speech on various aspects of India. There's one sensitive issue that I just wanted to ask you your personal opinion about, you know, the Cobra Gade incident, mm-hmm. Where one of the diplomats from India had a maid from India, and she was not paid at the U.S. minimum wage, and it caused our Manhattan prosecutor, Preet Bharara, to arrest her and so on. That caused quite a bit of a commotion. Has that affected at all India-U.S. Relations in any way?
I would say No. Our relationship is not so fragile that it will be affected by one such instance. In terms of what happened, I would like to say that both sides feel that it should have never happened. I rest my argument on that sentence.
Before we go to our next question, I'd like to welcome Congressman Brian Higgins, fresh off the plane from Washington.
Thank you, Bobby. I'm Brian Rusk, and I went with the Hope for Tomorrow Foundation to Calcutta on a humanitarian mission. And the first question is, what is being done in India to help with the poverty crisis still in Calcutta? And the second question is, how is the eradication of polio ending up? Is it finished in India now?
Yeah. Thank you very much for that question. Yes. To take your second question first, India has formally announced that for the last 3-5 years, no new cases of polio have been reported. So I think that's, and India has finally announced that it is polio-free country. I'm sure, you know, the authorities will be taking measures in the immediate, future not to recur it, because I think that was a hugely focused program and it has succeeded. It also shows that it's possible to do things in India. Yes, poverty has been a major issue. I call it an issue that, you know, arose out of our historic experience. You can partly call it social factors, partly economic factors, partly long duration of colonial rule in India. But we have faced the problem of poverty right from the beginning of our independence. So the first step what India did is really to become independent in food production, because we thought that if democracy has to survive, if sovereignty has to be maintained, people must have food. So as a result, in '70s, early '80s, India, you know, focused hugely on what we call green revolution. And we have been self-sufficient in terms of production of food grains. Not only that, we export. And we always have sufficient buffer stock of the food grains. In the post-independence period, particularly post-70s, India has managed all its shortages, particularly the droughts, on its own, without importing anything from outside. I think that's, considering that we were a huge net importer at the time of independence, feeding such a huge population was always a challenge, and that we have overcome. What now we are focusing and the successive governments have grappling with is really problem of poverty, problem of inequality. So now, and it has been, so there was a view that we should have more kind of a distributive socialism. But the focus with the new government is rather than distributive socialism, you really follow a path of allowing creativity, follow a path of, you know, employment generation, more economic growth, and then as a fallout, reduction of poverty. That's the new focus of this particular government. So in that sense, but that doesn't mean government can do away with welfare schemes altogether, because you have a section of the population which is really hugely impoverished, and they require special attention. So my hunch is, while the distributive socialism in terms of creating new schemes of, you know, distributing of wealth, some of those will be curtailed, rationalized, abolished, subsidies will be minimized, and the government will focus more on, you know, allotting funds to job creation, manufacturing, investment in growth areas. That is the way forward for reduction of poverty, to my mind.
We'll take one more question, and then perhaps Congressman Higgins would like to say a few words. Are you willing to take one more?
Yes.
Okay. Hi. I really liked all the parallelisms and partnerships that you mentioned between India and the U.S. I would like to mention one between Buffalo and India. In Buffalo, we have Dr. Jack Lippes, who's now 90 years old. And to him, you owe the Lippes Loop, which saved you from an overpopulation of sacred cows. He now has a new contraceptive that costs only 80 cents, and we need our U.S. government to fund it.
Okay, thank you.
I think it was more of a statement than a question. But one more question, and then we'll see if Congressman Higgins say a few words.
Hello, I'm Paul Kuchmansky, a psychology instructor here at Daemen, and I was delighted and surprised to hear about the election process in India. So maybe India should be monitoring elections around the country, around the world, instead of the United States. One quick question and one more complicated question, though. With the elections, how long does it take then to run an Indian election?
Yeah. We have the elections for about 6 weeks, and they go in phases. We got about 544 constituencies all over the country for the parliament. And at any given point of time, we take certain number of constituencies. So this time it was, I think, 5 or 6 phases. And at the end of it, we announce the results so that, you know, in between, people don't get influenced. So, but what you said about the cooperation on the election side, that I think is a fascinating thing, because we have a more diverse population, because we have perhaps more challenging terrains, we have also devised more innovative ways of reaching out to people and conducting the elections, and also making it as complete and perfect as possible in the given, you know, environment. And some of that experience can certainly be shared. And, you know, generally, it's a practice that the Western world sends its election observers to smaller countries. Maybe time has come when India should really participate actively in assisting U.S. In sort of improving the mechanism here.
So my question about the environmental, many with India emerging now as a more industrialized nation and a growing economic power, there's a number of concerns in the environmentalist community as to its current use of fossil fuels, and what about India's impact on the environment, and if there's any plan, you know, for more green energy or sustainability?
Yeah, I think Yes, thank you. Government is acutely aware of this particular aspect, both, and it believes that if we do not protect our environment, if we do not address the issue of climate change, you know, none of the humanity can really survive. The question of rising sea levels, for example. I was in Maldives, where the entire country, you know, 1,192 islands, they were at the sea level. So a rise of 1.5 meters means the entire country will be gone. But not only Maldives would be gone, maybe at least a few million people of India will be displaced, because wherever there is a seashore, wherever there is population, it will be completely affected. 1.5 meters is quite a bit of sea rise. And all of us will be in trouble. Wherever we are, Manhattan will be drowned if there is 1.5 meters more. And where will I go? So I think there is that awareness is there. However, there's also issues of equity and how do we achieve? We need technologies. And therefore, the developing country like India and developed country like US have to cooperate. We need technology. The technology needs to be given at a reasonable price. How do we match this, you know, incessant thirst and hunger for profit making and the real need of humanity? It ultimately is going to boil down to that when the leaders discuss. And if there isn't a reasonable solution, we might be finding our own ways to address the issue. But there is increasingly an awareness, including what I read of President Obama's recent statement on climate change, that there is a strong desire all over the world to cooperate on the issue. And I believe India has, for example, solar missions. India has a separate ministry that deals with renewable energy sources. India is trying to see how rivers can be restored. What it means is whatever effluents go to the rivers, they will have to be treated beforehand. As I said, Prime Minister himself has said that toilets, not temples, which is, it's also kind of a directional announcement from him. So I believe that we will be taking giant steps in that direction.
I'm going to violate my own rule and let Mr. Schimminger ask the last question.
First, a preface to the question, and because the congressman came in and didn't hear at all, I want to report to the congressman that okay. This talk was a real tour de force. It was inspiring. It was enriching. And we all want to go to India.
Thank you.
But this is the question. I understand that you were on national television back in May, around the time yes. of the elections in India.
Yes.
And I wondered whether you were able to get out this same comprehensive tour de force message when you were on national television. I think it was May 15th.
I think so, yes. That was a Jon Stewart show, Daily Show. I was there, and I think I was able to convince them to go to India. That's my single most important mission. And not only they went to India, they also, in addition to the episode where I participated, they made two more episodes on India and its elections. Because I think they really realized that it's so important to highlight the elections. Look at India's north, China, and its democratic situation, if you can use the word democratic there. Look at the countries even surrounding India. Even the smaller countries have problems in choosing their leaders and having their elections in time. Look at the Middle East. I'm not going to talk so much about Africa, because certainly, democracy is not very well established there. So if at all United States will have to find friends on the basis of values, it has to be India. You know, that's my single most important emphasis, that it has to be India. Yes, we can have disagreements. Good friends should have disagreements. And India would find it very difficult to become a subordinate ally, an ally which will not express its opinion. But I think for good debate, good discourse, good democracy, difference of opinion is a must, but you need to have a reliable friend. And that reliability can come only from commonality of values. To me, That is, you know, the beacon of light. Thank
you. Congressman Higgins.
Thank you, Congressman.
Ambassador, thank you very much. Again, I apologize. I just got off the plane from Washington. It was quite a week. You know, we dealt with the crisis situation in Iraq, the crisis situation in Israel and the Gaza Strip, the unfortunate after events of the Malaysian commercial flight being shot down, 295 people killed, innocent people, along in Ukraine, along that area that is controlled by the Russian separatists. It is alleged that they may have been responsible either deliberately or inadvertently because a surface-to-air missile is thought to have brought that jetliner down. But as the ambassador was speaking about the importance of this election, you know, India is an extraordinary place, and America has close ties to India. We had diplomatic relations with India before India obtained its independence. Much like the Indian population, the Americans hate their Congress. And you have a new prime minister, who was somewhat controversial initially because of his Hindu nationalistic tendencies several years ago. But I think what's happened here is he's now become prime minister of a country of 1.2 million people. He's become prime minister of a country that increasingly is becoming urbanized. He is prime minister of a country who boasts that half its population is under the age of 25. They're technologically sophisticated on social media. They see how the rest of the world is living, and they want in, and they want in. And the prime minister, in recent speeches, has made it very, very clear that the progress, the future of India is for all people. And India, too, is highly pluralistic. It has many, many ethnic groups. And I think that's critically important. As the ambassador said, India lives in a tough neighborhood. You look what surrounds India directly and separated sometimes by smaller countries, and it's a tough place. And here's what we've learned, I think more so than anything, about Southeast Asia and the Middle East, and that is this, that unless and until you have a respect for minority rights, you're never going to have peace. You know, what's going on in Iraq right now? Is that a fight for freedom and democracy? No, it isn't. It's a fight for power. It's a fight for power. It's the Shia and the Sunni fighting each other over who is the rightful successor to the Prophet Muhammad in the 7th century. You know, you look at the situation in Syria. You know, why are people helping out Bashar al-Assad despite the fact that he killed more than 100,000 of his people by use of chemical weapons? Because they too, Christians and other groups, are minorities, and they fear if the Sunni majority takes over, they will be slaughtered. There's a great book by Marwan Mawasher called The Second Arab Awakening that talks about this, that so long as the Middle East and Southeast Asia is a zero-sum game, the sum will always be zero. And that's what distinguishes, in a very, very good way, a great, great country like India. It fought nonviolently for its own independence and achieved what other countries could not. But it also has to embrace and has embraced minority groups to produce an extraordinary economy. An extraordinary economy that's technology is finding its way into the agrarian economy, helping farmers who are illiterate become more productive so that they too can move up in society. So we are pleased to have the ambassador here. This lecture series, started by Gary Olson, is a great, great contribution to the intellectual enrichment of the Western New York community. I was the first speaker. We also had Debbie Wasserman Schultz here, who was the National Democratic Chair and also a member of Congress from South Florida. Had Eric Cantor, who was formerly the majority leader, and when he was here, no one thought he wasn't going to be majority leader later on. And now you, Ambassador, to provide this very, very important international perspective about the commonality of the United States and India, and the hope that we can forge new relations, new and bolstered relations that will help stabilize that part of the world, that will help further integrate the extraordinary economy of India into the global economy, and that we can look at India as a shining example of what we want other countries to become in that part of the world. So thank you for taking some time to be here, and thank you for including me. And I also want to recognize Satish Tripathi, the great, great president of the University of Buffalo, for being here to introduce the ambassador. Robin Schimminger, the dean of the Western New York delegation, who continues to deliver in big, big ways for places like Roswell Park Cancer Institute and so many other places for Buffalo and Western New York. And my good friend, Dr. Bangu. Dr. Bangu is a plastic surgeon in South Buffalo, Irish South Buffalo. So you ask yourself, well, why is that? It's because all of our moms took us to the beach with no sunscreen. But Dr. Bangu does great philanthropic and humanitarian work throughout this country and throughout the world. He's a great friend, and he was very instrumental in helping secure the visit for the ambassador. So we're honored to have you here, and welcome to Buffalo and Western New York.
Well, this brings our show to a close, but let's have one last applause, not only for the ambassador, but for all the questioners and speakers. Thank you all.